And that's very much the case with me with the next one. Humble Pie were in the studio when we were still in the small studio, Presentation B, so there wasn't a lot of room, but there was a fantastic atmosphere about this particular session. The Blackberries were in fabulous voice, and Steve Marriott was doing the definitive Artful Dodger.
'64 was the first year of the 9/11. You could say it was the birth of the 9/11. Black coffee is my name. Black coffee, not a thing. Black coffee. It's just such an iconic shape, you know. It's the classic Porsche. When people think of Porsche, they think of 9/11, you know, and that shape has endured for almost 50 years, you know, and you can still look at the new Porsche today and you know it's a 911. They may call it a 997, but to everyone out there, there's a Porsche 911. My goal a few years back was to have one of every year from 64 through 73. Ironically, I got all the way to 72. I've yet to get the 73, but I did get the most difficult one, the 64. I don't have to go very far to get my kicks on those cars. I've got numerous little loops ranging from 2 miles to 100 miles that I can leave this desk and, you know, be having fun within 10 minutes. It is my backyard race ground. You know, and I've been pulled over a few times in this neighborhood. Once even at gunpoint, arms above, crazy stuff like that. But you know, it's just, it's all part of what I'm about, I suppose. Four-three bridge over there, garage 40 feet below us, chop shop 80 feet across the road, and the iconic 6th Street Bridge 200 yards away. Unfortunately, it's got what's known as concrete cancer, and the bridge is structurally crumbling from within. Believe it or not, they're going to tear that bridge down in the next 2 years and build some new modern cantilevered structure, which is forever going to change that particular skyline that you guys are shooting towards right now. It's also going to affect all my 100-mile sprints over the bridge. But hopefully they're going to put something there that's equally as cool with a little bit more of a modern twist that'll be my new sort of 0 to 100 test ground. A Porsche, you've got to go fast. You discover Mulholland, we're here in LA, you're racing around the canyons, and you know, of course, I got a lot of speeding tickets. Then I discovered the Porsche Owner Club in 2001 and actually did my first track day in 2002, almost 10 years ago. And that was when I really started sliding down what I like to call the Porsche slippery slope. Once I got bit by the Porsche track day bug, it becomes competitive. You start out time trialing, then you progress to club racing, you get your club race license. And then I started traveling. You know, I'd race Phoenix, California Speedway, Las Vegas Motor Speedway, Thunder Hill, Laguna Seca. Started instructing, and the more competitive the racing got, to be honest, after a couple of years, the less fun it became. So I sort of backed out of doing 40 track days a year, and all that money I'd spent racing, I started buying cars for restoration. In the 20 years of owning racing collecting, I've owned over 49 11s. When I first get the car, it's stripped down, brought over here, and all the rust is cut out, and the new fresh sheet metal is welded in, and the process of restoration begins. We jokingly refer to it as the chop shop. You know, instead of going online and trying to find that hard-to-find, no longer available part and waiting and hoping that it works, we just come over here, and whatever it is we need, we just cut it off the car and graft it onto the car inside. So I tell people these are giving life to new cars, the dying so someone else can live. The great thing about outlaws to me is no one's ever going to tell you that outlaw is not correct. You know, what I'm sort of becoming, I guess, known for now are these signature things that the factory never did. You know, here at the rear, we got the louvered deck lid, you know, becoming one of my signature touches. We have the integrated rear R-inspired turn signals that are grafted in, just like on my silver car. Those are aspects that when I first did them, I'm like, uh-oh, people are either going to love this or hate it. What turned out to be, you know, the hallmark of that 72 STR car I built was the grafted in R turn signals that normally people just screw that lens into place. It takes a lot of time and effort to actually graft it in so it's a smooth, integrated, clean look. So it's those little aesthetic touches that, to begin with, maybe you don't notice them. But when you start walking around the car, all of a sudden, there's something a little bit different from that car. It's something that people are drawn to. I'm building for myself on spec. It's this out-of-control hobby vibe of just enjoying the process all the way through.
So what if this takes off and people are knocking on your door? Is then you're going to lose the passion?
Well, that's a good question. You know, right now I'm sort of a little bit turning stuff like that down, and I'm telling people, hey, I'm not that guy. If you want someone to build you a car, these are the guys to go to. If you like what I'm building, this is what I'm currently working on. It's not necessarily, hey, let's try and make money on this. It's build what I really like to build. We'd been renting a warehouse and renting a loft from 1994 to 2000, and finally we realized, why are we paying two people's mortgages?
We were looking for either a place to live or maybe possibly a new building, because we were just renting at the time. We didn't own anything. And I came up and I saw this place, and he was like, absolutely not. And our broker was like, absolutely not, because it really was, it was a dump, to say the least.
Back then, it was sort of more of a transient, desolate industrial warehouse area, a lot of vagrant homeless activity. Descriptively, it's a 26,000 square foot, two-story brick building built in 1906, located here in the Arts District. It's actually a lot more than that, though. It's the dream home that Karen found for us that we spent 12 months restoring and building into the location that you've seen.
I saw the garage and I saw the kitchen. Those were the only two places that you could really get into and, you know, see, because everything was covered with tar. I mean, it was basically a dilapidated building. But when I saw those two, I thought, this is perfect. He can do his cars here. We can have Sirius downstairs. We can live upstairs. And it was just magical. I mean, I knew that that was a place that we should be.
out of that space, we've been able to grow and build several businesses, a Sirius clothing brand that we run, our downtown LA film locations business, which really enables us to have all these toys. And then also it does house my Porsche collection and expanding hobby, sideline restoration racing Porsche business. Fast forward 12 years later, there's about 1,000 luxury loft condos within a quarter mile radius of where we're sitting on this rooftop. People raising families, walking dogs, riding bikes around. For the first time in 17 years, you know, we've heard kids running around the neighborhood. That was something you never heard. Well, we're under the historic 4th Street Bridge, right in the heart of the downtown LA Arts District. We were in a big acquisition phase, probably 5 or 6 years ago, acquiring property in the neighborhood. You know, we had a vision after a trip from London where we saw all the creative stuff that had been done around the Tate Modern, South Bank, around the Thames, under similar structures. You know, the light bulb flashed yet again. It was like, wow, these guys have utilized all this derelict land under railway arches in London and converted it to everything from wine bars, bistros, nightclubs, gyms, all the way back to taxi cab stands and construction yards. So our theory was, hey, we're living in this neighborhood that's getting gentrified. We know there's not enough ground floor commercial, coffee shop, yoga studio, art gallery, just basic ground floor commercial. So the goal was to acquire the land, and the dream was one day to encapsulate these arches with these sort of floor-to-ceiling glass pods that would become commercial space for the uses that I just described. As a 10-year-old, my father took me to the London Earls Court Motor Show in 77, and there was a white Martini Turbo with a red and blue stripe. That was my dream car. I even wrote a letter to the Porsche factory at the age of 10. I think I said I wanted to design for Porsche. And the kicker is they even wrote me back and basically said words to the effect of, well, when you're older, give us a call. Speeds, what can I see in everyone? Like a lost idea under light bulb sun. Your eyes ready for takeoff. Porsche is a brand that's built on loyalty. And I would hope, you know, 35 years later, if I showed up with that letter and they saw what I'd built with their cars, I would hope they'd be smiling. You know, Sheffield is one of those places where a lot of people get stuck. What got me to America was basically working on a summer camp with kids and then took a Trailways bus from Detroit to LA, landed, ironically, a mile up the road at Union Station at 6 a.m. in the morning with a huge backpack, and I was in the in heaven. It was like the land of rock and roll. It was, hey, the grass is greener on the other side. Not having a ton of education was sort of great because I always describe myself as street smarts. You know, if you don't know where the boundaries and the rules are, hey, anything's possible. You know, I started selling secondhand clothing on the boardwalk in Venice Beach in 1989. I'd go to yard sales and buy old Levi's and thrift store finds, motorcycle jackets and cool boots, set up a booth on the boardwalk, and that led into the self-taught clothing design aspect. I always sort of knew what I thought looked cool on me and what I liked to wear. And so it was that trial and error. You don't know how to make something, you buy something you like, take it apart, trace that pattern, sew it back together, and as you do the first one, it's a little rough, the second one's better, and by the time you've done 10 of them, you're sort of getting the hang of it. That's how I started with clothing 25 years ago, and that's sort of the same way with Porsches. I didn't go to automotive school or don't necessarily have a mechanical background. I can swing a hammer and turn a screw and stuff like that, but it's that gut feeling of you're drawn to what you know feels right for yourself and what you're passionate about. Go get him, go get him, go get him, go get him. Here's the beauty shot right here. Here's the beauty shot. Well, that's great news, Pat. And the great thing about early Porsches is they are relatively simple, you know, a couple of wrenches, screwdrivers, and worst case scenario, blowtorch and a big hammer, away you go. Obsessive behavior, my wife would tell you all about that. You know, I don't sleep all the way through the night. A lot of times I am trying to mentally, I go through it in my mind, you know, what? How am I gonna make this work tomorrow? What's gonna be the better way to get that fender to fit or to install those seats or to get that bolt out where the head's sheared or whatever it may be, it's dummy running my mind. I gotta make the next one better. You know, it's sort of like when you hear about bands that have done the best album, you know, they've gotta up that with the next album. So for me, that's what drives me, is to make the next car better than the one that came before it. Right now I'm making my own little custom leather pull strap for the door. You know, I've been making my own door cards out of vinyl because I like to have the same continuity on the vinyl all the way through the car. Gotta make sure I don't cut my hair on this type of thing. Because you know what'll happen then? It's like the Samson story, lose all my strength. But, you know, it's just one of those cool things that doesn't necessarily jump out to begin with. But, you know, it feels good. Every time you open that door, you're sort of touching the leather. It's back to that patina thing. The leather's going to get better with age. It's my favorite old pair of shoes type of thing. You know, the more you touch it, the more you use it, the better it feels. So basically, it's just one of the many different things that I'm putting on my cars, personalizing them slightly. I'm just brushing glue onto the back. I'm going to wait for it to dry for a moment. Making a straight, straight crease. Trying to get the corners neat and tight. And then, like with most Porsche projects, it's time for the big hammer. Then I let this dry, and then I go sew it. We did used to have a bunch of great leather pants that, yet again, we had to do something differently. So what we did was we made the leather pants, then we actually stonewashed them, and then we hand-distressed them with sandpaper and wire wool. So even though they were brand-new, never-worn pants, they sort of looked like a creased-in, broken-down, beat-up, patinaed, old-school-looking biker leather pants that just happened to be brand-new. It wasn't like you had to
go through that blood, sweat, and tears and beat them up to make them look old. It wasn't just the look, it was the feel. You know, they were warning, comfortable the moment you put them on. So, you know, the door handle is sort of a similar process. The next thing I actually want to do is distress leather, like I said, on the skin, you know, like the raw hide like this, literally distress it, and then make a whole seat out of it. So the seat is already beat up and, you know, sort of creased in, but it's a new seat. That's probably the next step. You know, back to when we used to do those leather pants, after they came back from the stone wash, of course they were wet, and then when they dried, they were very, very stiff. So what we'd do is we'd literally get a wooden roller and we'd roll the leather pant backwards and forwards, just like this, to soften it up. Then we'd go in with sandpaper, heavy grit, fine grit, and sort of really scuff it up. You know, a lot of it's feel. I keep talking about the old shoes, the favorite pair of old jeans, why I wear multiple layers, the fabric of the shirt. It's sort of a comfort thing, you know? Sort of a tactile feel, sensory, you know, just even manipulating the leather here and trying to supple it up. So, you know, it's a 45-year-old car it's going into, you know, even though it may be shiny, these elements to it, it's that you want to be old. It's the same thing with those vintage Momo steering wheels that I love, whether it's, you know, the Mario Andretti one or the Jackie Stewart one. You can buy a Momo Protipo that's brand new, but there's no soul to it. It's all back to that feel, you know, whether it's a little piece of leather, the 30, 40-year-old steering wheel that's on it. You know, it's when your hands are on the wheel, you move to the shift knob, it's just a sensory overload type of thing. And I suppose, you know, the older the better for me. One wasn't enough, you know. It would be hard for me just to have one Porsche. You know, it's each one is rewarding and challenging, and there's something in each and every car in here that I'm really drawn to, no matter what car it is. You can't always say what it is. It's a feeling, you know. It's hard to describe, but when you're in that car, it's the smell, it's the sound, it's an adventure. There's a certain calmness to it because you're not really thinking about anything else. And it's all becoming second nature, and it does slow down. The further ahead you look, and you're always looking a long way ahead, you know, that sense of chaos, and there is a sense of calmness as well at the same time. So a lot of times, you don't actually even hear your own motor. You sort of find yourself, it's almost as crazy as it sounds, an out-of-body experience. heart pumping, you feel the blood pulsing through your veins, you sense the sweat dripping down. You're excited, you're exhilarated, and by the time you're done, you're probably exhausted. Still as passionate, I'm more passionate about it now than I was, you know, when I bought my first one 20 years ago. Then it was just a car. Now I feel like it's in my blood, it's part of my soul. You know, it gets me out of bed, I'm driven, you know. It's just ingrained, you know. I can't wait to get up and come into this space. Sometimes I just sit over there, turn the lights down, and I just look at the way the light hits the car and the way the shadow moves over the fender and drops down. And I'm grinning on the inside. You know, I've got this post going on Pelican Parts. People are like, why are there no photos of Magnus smiling? I'm like, I'm smiling on the inside. You know, I'm not one of those guys that's a smiley, touchy-feely type of guy, but I'm a passionate guy. And that's basically, I suppose, my obsession with Porsche. It's a passion. Porsche passion.
You know, I think we're finally getting comfortable that his reputation is caught up with, you know, all the cars out there. I mean, he really does get tons and tons of people that admire him. You know, there's times when the bank account's gone because he's bought two or three cars in a row. Doesn't faze him in the slightest. He just knows that he's going to make it work. And I trust him on that.
From appearance-wise, I'm not your typical Porsche-looking guy. Not that there is one, but, you know, there's not a lot of bearded, dreadlock, tattooed Porsche guys out there. There's a few of them, but actually, I don't know any of them. So I think that is part of the mystique. It is this cool guy that looks like a rock and roll homeless dude that people are not really sure about, but hey, he's got some pretty great bitchin' Porsches that he's built, restored, and races, and it's becoming sort of, I think, part of the charm, you know. I mean, people are now wanting me to build cars. You know, I'm seeing, as crazy as this sounds, on some of these bulletin boards, ex-Magnus Walker 911. People seem to put a certain cachet to a car that I've owned or built. So that reputation is evolving. Almost 20 years ago, back to my Americana Stars and Stripes things, I made a really, really cool soda myself. Heavy, heavy vinyl. It looked like leather. Pair of Evel Knievel-inspired tight pants. They were blue with a 4-inch cream white ivory stripe down the side and a 4-inch die-cut star. There were probably 8 stars spaced about 2.5 inch down with a big chunky zipper. It became the Sirius trademark. Everything had stars if it was Sirius, or you could tell just by looking at it that it was a Sirius item. just evolving, whether it's sewing or buildings or design or now sort of air-cooled Porsches. It's that same aesthetic feel that's becoming a little bit of a trademark that you can put your name on a style. You know, oh, that's a serious item, or that's a Magnus sports purpose, or inspired Porsche. You know, so it's sort of that same common thread.